Alternatively, we have some species that physiologically are warm season. They really don't start growing until May. Their productivity rate is greatest through June into July, maybe early August, and then slow down in September and stop with the first cold frosts. Distinctly different in terms of species. From a forage selection and management situation, if you're planting or interseeding or tweaking your system, we don't typically recommend adding a warm season perennial species or annual species to a cool season grass. It's just too hard to manage everything and keep things growing well. Alternatively, we would suggest using dedicated warm season grass pastures or paddocks. Let them grow best and use them best when they're most appropriately used. So if you're thinking about a warm season component to make up the deficit in the summer, think about multiple paddocks in a separate pasture or paddock or several for that purpose. So as you look at your whole farm plan, and this is part of your strategy, which pastures are going to be appropriate for warm season? Probably not going to be the ones that you're going to be turning at calving time. These are probably ones that are going to be further back in the pasture rotation that you're going to be using later in the season. They're probably not the ones you're going to be grazing in the fall and winter with water availability issues. Warm season grass or warm season species seems to fill in that gap very nicely. It's productive when our cool seasons are not. So it's intriguing. As we look at our pastures, many of our annual grassy weeds are warm season grasses. Foxtail, crabgrass, actually are serving that role now as a warm season grass. What are some of those options for planting a warm season paddock or two? Certainly the perennials come from our prairie species. And NRCS and universities and USDA have been working to try to sort among the wild types and genetic varieties and variances of big blue stems and switchgrasses and Indian grasses to come up with more productive, suitable species for production use. They all have a similar type of growth pattern. They don't, once established, they don't start growing until May. They really aren't usable until mid-June and are usable through the summer months, either continuously through the summer months or rotationally. Like most grasses, they tolerate lower pHs than legumes. They're not without their need for some fertility. Pretty good quality when they're vegetative. They become much less palatable. And among those, the Indian grass is probably, and eastern gamma grass, are probably the most palatable. Big blue stem is pretty palatable. Switchgrass is probably the least palatable. Among those, the heading date is a factor, and we'll talk about that here in a little bit. But the switchgrass heads out first in the summer, so it becomes less palatable sooner than big blue stem and Indian grass. So if you're mixing species in a mixed warm season, switchgrass is always going to be a problem, because the cows will start ignoring it as it gets more and more mature. The annual Sudan grasses, the sorghum family, can be planted for emergency forage. Pretty palatable, has to be planted. It's an annual, can be have multiple harvests. Sudan grass and sorghum Sudan hybrids can be grazed, they can be mechanically harvested. There are some downsides. They become less palatable as they get more and more mature. They can accumulate nitrates under the conditions in the summers. And prussic acid, a cyanide compound, can develop in these sorghum plants. Management is based on plant height when it is used. The taller the plant, the more mature it gets, the less and less the cyanic acid problem becomes. And we don't recommend using sorghums for horses because of a cystitis issue. Not much value after frost. They tend to break up pretty quickly after once they're frozen. Millets, another annual group, used in midsummer, multiple growth cycles. Foxtail millet, only one growth cycle, and which I'm showing here, sometimes called German millet, Siberian millet. No prussic acid, but it grows fast and has to be utilized pretty much within the first 6 weeks of its growth, and it doesn't recover after that. Some other millets, Japanese millet, hybrid pearl millet, will have multiple growth cycles, but again, warm season species. What can we do to extend the fall grazing? Need to think about this in your grazing plan. Rye has been used more and more, cereal rye planted in late August, sometimes in standing corn and beans, sometimes after the crop is harvested. Utilized for some grazing in the fall, it will generally recover and be available in early spring. Has some desirable advantages there. The awns, particularly in the spring growth, can become a problem. On the seed heads, the beards on the heads can be an anti-quality issue. We could accumulate some nitrates under the certain conditions. Also works by extending the grazing season in the spring. Really doesn't start growing that much earlier, but it will gain you several weeks of spring grazing compared to your normal pasture systems. Not much else can provide that kind of early start in the grazing system. Winter wheat might be able to be a similar characteristic. So miscellaneous other species, quickly, do they fit? Maybe. Are they appropriate? Maybe. Perennial ryegrass and annual ryegrass. All variations, sometimes called Italian ryegrass. They're diploids, tetraploids, big mix of ryegrasses. Historically, they have not been well adapted to Iowa. They don't have enough winter hardiness to survive as long term, even though it's called perennial. You might get a year or two out of it, but typically it will winter kill. From the deep south, they usually grow the ryegrasses as a fall planted winter grass species. It grows in the Pacific Northwest, well up in the Northeast. It is a maritime species. Grows best around ocean climates, stable, moist environments. New Zealand, British Isles, East Coast is the best place for the ryegrasses. The companies have been trying to develop more and more cold hardiness into varieties. I've not given up on the ryegrasses. I think they're improving in their persistence characteristics. They're good quality, well managed. They do respond to good management. There are some alkaloids similar to tall fescue if you pick the wrong kinds of species. The turf industry sells ryegrasses. They tend to have very high levels of alkaloids to provide stress tolerance to the turf species. So if you're planting it for forages, plant forage varieties that are low endophyte. Talked about fescue. This is another fescue that is receiving some attention, particularly in Wisconsin. Meadow fescue is doing very well. Grows almost as productively as tall fescue. Slight variations in its growth, can have some alkaloid issues. There are some varieties being marketed. Similar in a lot of characteristics with tall fescue. Brassicas, the mustard family. Turnips, kale, the leafy types of brassicas certainly are possibles. They will extend the grazing into the fall. If planted in late summer, can be planted in very, very early spring for some spring growth. They have to be managed. They're not perennials. They are not legumes. You do have to put some nitrogen on them. The sheep industry has been most interested in the brassicas. Corn. Cows like corn. They'll eat corn at any stage. And we can use corn as a supplemental forage at almost any stage. Typically, it's used later in the season. Can actually be grazed clear into the fall and winter. The more and more grain that develops on it, the more caution you need to monitor and moderate the amount of starch that they're taking in with grain at any point in time. So there's some management that goes along with corn.